So we're talking about this world is really carnal. And what I mean by that is you guys have a lot stacked against you when it comes to social media, Netflix, HBO, everything that we have available at our fingertips. And if you're not careful, you can just get sucked right into it. And you begin to see things and think things that are just normal. And I want to challenge you guys to go ahead and balk against this system and go ahead and take some time to get quiet before the Lord and pray and get to know Him, and it'll benefit you greatly. So that's what this month is all about, why we're talking about prayer time. Go, Pokemon came out, and I just really want to talk about prayer. And prayer should be something that's very important to your life. And like literally, we've been doing youth ministry for 12 years, 13 years. And if I interviewed every one of you, especially you Christian kids, like, what's God telling you to do right now? You're like, pray more. I should read my Bible more. I need to pray more. I should pray. And tomorrow I'm going to try to pray. And you never do really pray. You just keep telling us how you should pray. And we're waiting for you to pray, but you don't pray. So it's time to start to actually pray. And honestly, looking back over the course of my life, Jackson, what really separated me and made me different was the fact that like God was really real to me and I had a prayer life. And that's what kept me. And if you look at really great men in history, D.L. Moody, John G. Lake, Smith Wigglesworth, people who had miracles operating in their life, they were generally speaking men of great, deep prayer. They go hand in hand, and somehow we've missed it as a Christian society that we're just like, yeah, I'm going to pray over my food, I'm going to pray when I need something, but rather than treating prayer like a time that you really just simply fellowship with your Father. This has always been about relationship. It's not about this big God that's way far and distant, but the Bible says that He will be in you, He will dwell among you, and you don't need anybody to teach you because God will teach you Himself. That's like essentially what that scripture is all about. But open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 10. We're going to open up with some scripture, then we're going to pray, and man, it's going to be a good night. If you don't have your Bible, no big deal. We do encourage you to bring your Bible, but if you forgot it, we got a big Bible on the screen for you. I'm excited about the school year. We are going to go for a big number of 100 young people in this service. We're going to shoot out there and just go crazy. We're going to probably bring in a guest minister maybe one night. We're going to, on October 5th, we're going to call the night Rep Your School. And we want to see what school can represent the most. And so it's just going to be a wonderful night. You're going to want to come. You're going to want to hang out. You're going to want to take off whatever sport you got to get here that night. It's going to be a sweet night. So we got big plans coming up ahead. So summertime is a time that you guys can get sharpened, develop your relationship with the Lord so that when you get back into school and there's so much peer pressure and there's so many like distractions, not to mention just work to do, that you're still going to stay the course. That's what summertime should be. It shouldn't be a lazy time. It shouldn't be a time where you just get on level 32 on Pokemon Go, unless you're Nikolai. It should be a time that you actually connect with God more and get spiritual. And that's what camp's all about. So if you're thinking about coming to camp and you still haven't decided, dude, listen to me. I'm rambling a little bit tonight. It's so vital that you go to camp. And I'm not just, and I know I pick on some of you guys, and you're like, why are you always bugging me? Why, you just want people camp? I want you at camp. The reason why is because I believe that God is able to speak at camp. Not because God can't speak here, it's because you take time aside to actually listen. God can really speak to you anywhere. But the truth is camps, what happens specifically at camps is we pull you away from your normal life for a little bit and you're able to connect with God. And man, if I can get you to connect with God, I can change your life. I know it. Some of you guys' lives have been wrecked since women's conference. Why? Because you got in God's presence. What would happen if you spent 365 days a year in God's presence? Would you be a different person? Absolutely. Acts chapter 10, verse 9 says, the next day, as Cornelius' messengers were nearing the town, Peter went up to the flat roof to play Pokemon Go. What does it say? Peter went up on the roof to check his Facebook, to do another selfie. No, it says Peter went up to the roof to pray. In his downtime, he went and prayed. And it was about noon, and he was hungry. Peter got hungry too. But while a meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. And he saw the sky open, and something like a large sheet was let down in four corners, and the sheet was all sorts of animals, reptiles, and birds. Then a voice said to him, get up, Peter,
kill, and eat.
What a strange dream. He's having like a hunting dream for my Banks people, okay? He's like, what? Kill with my bare hands? I'm a caveman. This is awesome. But verse 14, Peter says, no, Lord. Peter declared, I have never eaten anything that our Jewish laws have declared impure or unclean. Jewish laws limited the amount of things that, that a Jewish man would eat and would not eat. He would not eat something raw. But the voice spoke again and says, do not call something unclean if God has made it clean. The same vision repeated three times, and then the sheet suddenly pulled up to heaven, and Peter was very perplexed in what this vision could mean. At the same time, a couple of men came by, and just for the sake of time, they came by, and Peter was showing, God was showing Peter a vision about don't call something unclean that is that God has made clean. And Peter, with this knowledge, with this vision, God opened up a door for him to go to a Gentile's house. A Jewish man would have never gone to a Gentile's house. He would have never hung out, would have never even eaten. Basically, a river, if you were a Gentile and I was a Jew, we would not eat food together. It may even be to the point where I would completely go of the other side of the street if you were walking by. And that was Peter's doctrine. That was Peter's thinking. And so God, in a vision, through prayer, showed Peter, says, no, this is where I'm taking you. This is the next step in your life. And thanks be to God, Peter was obedient to that. He went and he began to preach at this guy Cornelius' house. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit fell. The place got rocked and a crazy Holy Ghost party. And all of a sudden, people were praying in the Holy Ghost and their whole lives were changed. God went to the Gentiles. And actually, truth be told, we are a part of that. Because none of you guys are Jewish, right? Okay, so you're a Gentile. And thanks be to God that God, through prayer, was able to take an ordinary day on a rooftop, make it extraordinary. Tonight, I'm going to speak to you on the subject of don't be generic. Don't be generic. If you're taking notes, you do need a couple thousand notes to get into heaven. That is biblical. It's in Hesitations 23. You can look it up. Don't argue with the Word of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the Word tonight. Help me preach. Help the students listen. And I pray that we'd leave this place inspired to pray. Inspired to walk with you in a greater measure, not just be ho-hum in our Christianity, not be generic, not be base model, but Father, really live in the supreme like we're supposed to be. Thank you so much for it in Jesus' name, and bless everyone who sneezed in my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Sorry to embarrass you. I really don't know who that was. Man, who likes cheap things? Oh, awesome. Nobody. Awesome. Generic is such an ugly word to me, you know? I mean, honestly, there was a day where I used to have 180 pair of dollar jeans. I'm not lying. I did have a couple of pairs of those. I don't know why. I don't know how I ever afforded those. I think I make more money now, but I would never even think about getting those right now. I mean, I don't know. I have kids now. I have, like, other bills that I'm like, why would I wear them? But they're pretty nice. Diesel jeans, they're pretty cool. You know, whatever. But generic jeans or whatever, you know? But generic, most things are really bad. Anybody ever get like a generic, not like Cocoa Puffs, but you got like brown balls, or I don't know what they're called, you know? And you're like, thanks, Mom. You know, it's like, they're not even like Cocoa Puffs. Or my favorite is like the generic brand of like cornflakes. It's not even real cornflakes. It's like flakes of corn. It's called, you know, it's something like corn bits or something. And you're like, this isn't even the same, you know? And you eat, you're like, yeah, it's not even the same. And generally, a generic brand of something is a much lower quality than the real thing, than the upper, you know, nicer stuff. Has anybody ever got a generic rent-a-car? You know, maybe your parents were trying to save money. You guys don't rent cars. A generic rent-a-car, it's cute when you're in college. You know, when you're like on a budget, you're like, hey, look at this little thing. This is fun. We were on a honeymoon. And we were on a budget because we were broke when we were 20 years old. And so we're on a honeymoon, and we're in L.A., and we're like, you know what? We're going to get just a PT Cruiser. You know, if you have a PT Cruiser, I'm sorry. Oh, dear Lord. I think that thing only comes with two rats inside, and sometimes they take turns napping. I'm not quite sure it's an engine inside. But anyway, so we just decided to take the generic car because we don't need a big, expensive car. It's a rental car. Who cares? And I'm on the freeway, pedal to the metal. And if you've ever been in LA traffic, you need to drive 90 miles an hour just to stay with the flow of traffic. Otherwise, you get ran over. And so I'm like, and I'm like, its car is going 85. Like, it's all that's got. The rat's sleeping. So a generic brand nobody likes. I did get a chance to drive a Ferrari. I'm sorry, it was a Lamborghini. I drove a Lamborghini one time. It was around a track, and I understand why people pay. At first, I wasn't even, actually, my sister got it for me for a birthday present. And so I was like, I would have never paid for it, but my sister was gracious. And so I was like, all right, yeah, sure. I was kind of looking forward to it, but I wasn't thinking it was a big deal. I'm like, what's the big deal? It's a big, expensive car. But I drove that Lamborghini, and I was like, what in the world? Daddy wants a Lamborghini. Why? Because the generic compared to the top of the line, there's a big difference. That thing can take corners at 80 miles an hour. Like it's just, I'm like, this thing's amazing. Big difference between generic and name brand. Anybody ever taken a generic clothing or generic shoes? Payless shoes bother me. If you still shop there, that's great. But like my wife loves Payless shoes. I don't know why. They get a hole in them in like a month. And I'm like, there's no point in buying a Payless shoes. You got to buy 10 a year. And you could just buy one pair of good shoes and then you'd just be good. But that's just my thinking on that. Generic is no good. Generic anything. Anybody, I was shopping for generic. I was actually shopping for laundry detergent. First off, there's a lot of laundry detergent. You ever shop for laundry detergent? You got Tide and like Tide Special Clean and like organic something. It's like $17.99. Seriously, it's like 17. I'm like $17. And then you got like Sunflakes or something like that. And it's like $4.39, you know? And I'm like, it's essentially the same thing, right? You're just cleaning your clothes. But how many know if you try Sunflakes or Sunflares or whatever it's called, the $4.39 is not nearly as good. Why? Because everybody likes the name brand. You know, when our Christian walk, if we're not careful, we can turn our prayer life into just a very generic prayer life. We can turn it into a kind of a surface relationship, just barely get by. It's got the ingredients of prayer. It kind of looks like prayer. We pray over our food from time to time, and it can be very generic. If you're not careful, that's where you live, is just in this generic spot. It's like, yeah, God's good, whatever. But there's a whole nother level to prayer. There's a whole nother level where you can begin to actually, God will show you things to come. God will speak to you in the midnight hour. You can be up on a rooftop like Peter in the middle of the day and just decide, I'm going to pray, I'm going to seek the Lord, and man, I'm waiting for food because I'm hungry, but I'm going to wait. And God can turn an ordinary day into something extraordinary when you take the time to pray. But if we're not careful, young people, you live in this generic state. I don't know. Is God going to be there? I don't know. Let me check my Snapchat. What college should I go to? I don't know. I'll just choose one. What should I do with my time? Who cares? And it's like generic. And listen to me. The scariest thing is that some of you guys never have even experienced a prayer time that is vibrant, awake, alert, alive, and you don't even know what it's like. And then you're sitting there looking on, you're an outsider looking in and wondering what all these Christian fanatics are freaking out about. You're like, psh, it's a bunch of, Pastor Nate's just a fanatic. He's just a weirdo. He's not in touch with culture these days. I mean, look at him trying to have skinny jeans. He looks funny. You don't even know what you're missing out on because all you've had is generic. All you've had is surface. The Bible says that he will show you things to come. Do you realize that when I was 14 years old, and I'm not telling you an experience that I think you need to live by or believe for. I'm just telling you what happened to me. I was praying in the Holy Spirit in my bedroom, which I did very regularly. So, but I get it. God stopped me midway and said, hey, you're going to marry Megan. I remember in my room stopping and being like, what? I didn't even like her. I really didn't. I was like, what? And thanks be to God, we have a good pastor. He taught me that he says, if you hear something and it doesn't really make sense, just go ahead and put it on the back burner. If it comes to pass, it comes to pass. If it doesn't, it doesn't. And you just made, you know, you don't be led by every voice you think you hear. So I was mature about it. I was like, man, that's weird. And I kind of put it on the back burner, if you may. If like on a stove, you know, you know what the back burner is, you just kind of let it wait. And so that's what I'm saying is I put that, and lo and behold, this is what happened. God showed me that in prayer when I was like 14 or 15 years old. That's ridiculous. You tell that to the world, you tell that to somebody out there, you know, at Great Clips, like, hey, what's up? God told me who I was going to marry when I was 15. They'd be like, oh, really? You're a psycho. Really? Why? Because the Bible says he takes the wisdom of the world and it's foolishness to him. And this is foolishness to the world. We don't make sense to the world. But listen to me, you can have an extraordinary life. You can have a life better than other people, knowing and sidestepping problems and sidestepping things that, and people say, man, it's like you're always at the right place at the right time, saying the right thing to the right person. Man, you're just so gifted in that. Man, how did you ever land that job? How did you ever do that? And you say, I prayed. God showed me that. Do you know that we talked about a little bit about 2 weeks ago, but Jesus literally said, I only do that which my Father tells me to do.
A little prideful, aren't you, Jesus? Really, everything you do? That riding that donkey? Jesus, God told you to ride the donkey? Really, everything?
I don't think he was exaggerating. I think he was literally spending, it's kind of like a computer. You need to plug in so that you can download so that then you can live it out. Some of you guys have never plugged in. And you have no clue what you're missing. You have no understanding. Listen to me, I'm talking to you sixth graders. Because if you can get this to habit now, you're gonna completely miss all the stupidity that some of these ninth graders, some of these 10th graders have gone through. How many of you 10th graders wish you guys would have prayed more when you were junior hires? Come on, be honest. How many of you guys wish you would have plugged in just a little bit more? Hey, guess what? You know what? If I brought some college students in here, I said, how many of you college students wish you would have prayed a little bit more when you were in 9th, 10th grade? You'd be like, holla. I read my wife's journal. I shouldn't tell you this, but she was like psycho, you know? Like, dude, she was weird. And I say it nicely, you know, as nice as you can say that, but she was crazy. And I was like, thanks be to God, she found Jesus, and she was a pastor's kid. But what happened was she developed a life of no prayer, no communion with God, and when you disconnect from the power of God, your problems become bigger and bigger, and things become more confusing. And listen to me, you might not even know that the devil himself is speaking to you, trying to get you off track, putting people in your life, giving you these feelings and giving you these thoughts, and if you're not hooked up in the prayer, they're normal to you. And they think that, some of you guys, the devil tells you, you should commit suicide. You should do this. Yeah, nobody likes you. You're not important. And then you go around thinking like, yeah, I'm just having these thoughts. It's just who I am. No, those aren't your thoughts. That's the enemy trying to snuff out your life. Trying to make you not matter. And I want to challenge you guys today. I don't want to live mediocre. And neither do you. Neither do you in your heart of hearts. If I interviewed each and every one of you, you'd be like, no, I want to do something great. I want to do something extraordinary. Well, how are you going to be extraordinary? How are you going to take a normal rooftop lunch and make it extraordinary, something that's lasting? You're going to have a prayer life. And you know what's so crazy? It's like, I can't make you do it. I can't be like, call you up every one of you in the morning. Hey, good morning. How are you praying? Praying right now? Are you doing it? Are you doing it now? How about now? Are you praying? I mean, really? How exhausting would that be? And also, God won't do that to you either. He'll give you slight unction. He'll, and you, some of you have felt it. You're like, hey, I should probably pray right now. Pokemon Go. And guys, our world is so distracting. It is. And it's tough. But you got to get it right. It's like Erica and a couple of us are on a diet right now. I'm trying to drop weight and stuff. And like, basically, you don't eat any food that's anywhere. Like, you can't eat anywhere bad. You can't, like, why? Because I'm going for something different than everybody else has. You can't do the same thing everybody else is doing and expect to get different results. And people out in the world, they don't know God. A lot of them. Many of them do not have a working relationship with God. Many of them do not walk and talk with him on a regular basis. Name one person in your life that you know that they could pray and you know that they could help you get healed. Name one. I mean, some of you might have a couple of people. Some of you guys might have a couple of people. How many guys would say, well, I don't really know too many? Or I should say, name somebody who doesn't go to this church that you might know. Your spiritual family, it's okay. You see what I'm saying? It's a rarity. The world, name one person in your high school that believes the same way you do when it comes to faith and healing and trusting the Lord. It's very, very few what I'm saying. This is not common. Prayer time, devotions, it's not common. But if you want to be extraordinary, this is what you do. And it's super simple. Set some alarms on your phone. Set some real life, say, man, this is my prayer time. Nothing takes the place of it. Not, man, if I need to be at work at 8, that means I'm praying it at 7. Man, even if it's just 15 minutes, don't get even locked into like an hour or like 20 hours. I mean, whatever you like to pray. Look at the scripture. Go to Thessalonians 5. This is something that I know that kept me in life. It was about sixth grade, I began to pray. Kiara, our family's crazy, right? This is my niece. Our family's pretty nuts, okay? I tell your mom from time to time that I'm disowning our family. I'm sorry, it's true. But our family's crazy, and I probably should be crazy. I probably should be a nut. But at sixth grade, I began to pray. I'm serious. I just began to seek God. And I'm not even like saying in this like, I began to seek God. Thanks be to God that God, like I listened and I prayed, but God mellowed me out. And I remember in the craziness of my family, I would just be like, shut the door. Father, I bless you and praise you and honor you. And it was his presence would come in my room. And guys, I would open up my mouth. I mean, Pastor Rebecca tells stories, and I think about it, and sometimes I wonder whether it was even me. Pastor Rebecca tells stories about Jackson. It'd be like me saying, all right, Jackson, you're preaching tonight. Go.
Okay.
CC, you're preaching tonight. Go. It'd be crazy, right? And I'd get up. I'd get up and like, open up your Bibles to this, and I'd just begin to preach. Well, what? How would that happen? I was spending time with God. There's an overflow that comes through prayer. There's an overflow that comes through supreme. You ever got something really nice? We're talking about generic versus the name brand stuff. Name brand stuff, you get in, you're like, oh, this is nice. This is, my Kia doesn't have this. This is nice. Anybody drive a BMW before? It's just like, holla. There's one BMW, it's a 7 Series. It has like massagers while you drive. Why? That's amazing. Why not? A Tesla drives itself. You're like, this is nice. My Kia don't do this. And guys, people driving around in a Kia, they don't even know that there's a Tesla when it comes to prayer. You know what I mean? People are like, I prayed the other day for my food and it was really amazing. I felt the Jesus presence come down and I think he really blessed my food. You know, it's like, and you're like, that's awesome, man. Like, but do you know that you could pray? Let me tell you a story. There was a grandma praying, and she was vacuuming. She was praying. This is a true story. It happened in Oklahoma. The pastor saw the front page. She's praying, and all of a sudden she stops, and she begins to pray for a baby. She just feels the Lord talk to her about praying for a baby and praying for the safety of the child. She begins to pray for this baby, the safety of the child. Little did she know at the same exact time, some drug parents were fighting and whatever, and they grabbed the baby and they threw it out the car window. And a police officer off duty was right behind the on the freeway. They were driving very fast on the freeway. They looked and they saw it, and it said it was recorded in the newspaper. It says it looked as if hands came, lifted the baby, put it down, and set it right down, and it completely landed on the side of the freeway unscathed, unhurt. Well, what happened? Little grandma was available to pray. Do you know that you can go distances in the spirit? You can go places in the spirit. Pastor Rebecca, one time I was there, I was present. We were getting ready for Peru. And we would meet here in church and we would pray. We'd pray in a circle of about 7 of us. I was 15 years old. So vracada, and we just crying out to God. God, use us. God, we pray for Peru. And she says, I saw a little man, no teeth, and orange hat, orange shirt. And she described this man, and she described him in the prayer time. She says, we were praying for this man. We get down to Peru a couple weeks later, and I remember seeing her face. She said, there he is. And the man came up, and he got saved and got healed. Why? What happened? It was coming in through prayer. That's extraordinary, guys. That's not your normal generic stuff. That's not your generic Christianity. That's something named brand. That's something special that's available to you. Paul, Jesus said it this way in John 16. He says, I will show you things to come. I will show you things to come. You know, psychics and mediums and all that. That is a perversion of what God has got for the natural believer. People on the side of the road are like, come, I'll read your fortune. And they're still big business. There's people, you can even drive down TV highway and you can find them. You know, it's crazy. It's like real life. People have businesses doing this. And generally, they're operating by the help of Satan. It's not God. And this, Satan's very aware of what's going on. And so I would stay very far away from those things. Mind you, you shouldn't be reading your horoscopes or anything like that. Horoscopes, whatever they're called. Don't read those either. But God will literally tell you things to come. Don't you want to know what you want to do with your life? Don't you want to pray out the plan of God for your life? Or do you want to be... I was practicing a little reverse psychology with my little girls the other day. I said, babies, if you want to be strong, pray. But you guys probably don't want to be strong. So go ahead and never pray. Play Xbox all the time. And they're like, no, we want to be strong. You know, like, I'm like, no, it's okay. You probably don't want to be strong. Don't worry about being spiritually strong. Just watch a lot of iPad and watch YouTube. Never pray. Never read your Bible. Never remember. And they're like, no, we're going to pray. We're going to be strong. And so then they began to pray. And it was so simple as a kid. They're like, duh, why would I not be strong? Why would I be weak? It's somehow we talk ourselves out of our prayer times. I'm too busy. Man, I got to get to work. God understands. Man, I got lots of stuff to do. And I can't imagine you guys' schedules right now. Okay, right. A lot of you sleep until what? 11, 10, 1, Kiara, 1 o'clock, 2, a lot. You got time. And listen to me, if it gets to the point where you feel like you legitimately don't have time to pray, that means you might need to cut some things out. That means other things need to go, not your prayer life. D.L. Moody said it this way: If he knew that he was having a busy day ahead, maybe he had to, you know, extra things to do. Rather than push prayer aside, he says, "Man, I that means I got to wake up earlier to pray because I need to connect with God and find out how this day is going to go." And you see what I mean by living generically? Some of you guys might not recognize God, might not recognize His voice. Sometimes you even say, "Like I don't feel like I ever hear His voice." Well, how much do you pray? How much do you talk with Him? How much do you fellowship with Him? Like, well, I never do. How would you hear His voice if you never talked to Him? And what's so cool about God, guys, the second you say, God, what's up? He's right there. He's right there to give you wisdom. And it's amazing what He'll show you. I didn't read this, but 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16, it says, always be joyful. What? How can I do that? Never stop praying. Never stop praying. Like, really? Really? Never? Never. Never stop praying. Being thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ. I want to know God's will for my life. Oh, Pastor Nate, what about God's will for my life? Never stop praying. No, I want something really deep in revelation. I need to... Never stop praying. If you guys got to drive to work, well, maybe ride your donkey to work. Soon. You will drive. And you're praying while you drive. Or you walk, praying while you walk. It might even take you longer. You know, that's where my prayer life started. I would walk to Highland Park Middle School half an hour each day. And I just made a commitment to God. I says, you know what, God? I don't walk with any friends because I have no friends. But I will pray every day. And I really, right away, I sensed Him telling me, you're doing a good job. It was almost like a pat on the back. He's like, good for you. He says, come pray in your bedroom. I said, okay. And I did. And I lived happily ever after. Okay, keep going. Ephesians 6, it says, pray in the Spirit at all times. What? 6:18, pray in the Spirit on all times, in every occasion. Stay alert. Be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. How often are you praying for other believers in your prayer times? Or are you praying just about yourself? Ooh. Would you describe your prayer time as generic or name brand? Would you describe your prayer time as kind of ho-hum or really amazing? And the choice is yours. It's not up to God. Philippians 4, verse 6, it says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. How many of you guys ever worried about something? You're like, oh no, what am I gonna do about this? Oh no.
Shut up, stop it.
Pray instead. You're so mean. I didn't say it, the Bible did. You don't hate, what about my feelings? Tell your feelings to God in prayer. It'll be good. And listen to me, guys. As a Christian, you have no business being stressed. Oh, I'm so stressed. I've heard people who stress, it is like temporary atheism. You really believe that God will not show up in your case. I want to challenge you guys. Let's have a vibrant prayer life. Let's be people of prayer. Let's be people that if there's a drug dealer baby getting thrown out of a window, we're available to pray. I'm serious. You guys don't know what's available. You don't know. I've even heard stories about the Berlin Wall in 1990. There was a bunch of prayers in the United States, and they swear, they said, that thing came down after we prayed. We got the crazy elections going on, right? Crazy one way and crazy another way. How many of us are, instead of judging and making decisions in Facebook posts, are praying? God, Father, help this country. Help us, please, Jesus. You know we need help. How often do we hit our knees and to ask God for what we really want? How many guys, instead of complaining about how bad and dark your school is, begin to pray for it? How many guys, instead of complaining, there's drugs everywhere, everybody's so bad at school, start praying for it? Man, my parents are always harping on me. Start praying for them. Man, I'm so stupid. I never get my math right. Start praying for yourself. Lord, help me. Give me the mind of Christ. Give me wisdom. And then I'm so worried about my grades. Cast all your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. Can we do it? Let's pray. Come on. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We're going to get the band up here in just a second. But I want to first make a stop here in the first step. I don't know everybody in here, but this is serious business. And some of you sixth graders, maybe you even said this prayer at one time, but this, I'm gonna give you an opportunity tonight to get saved, to get born again, to call on the name of Jesus for the very first time. If you've asked Jesus into your heart, you're saved, you're born again. But if you have never said, Jesus, come into my life, make me a new creation, if you've never had that experience, the Bible says that that's a saved experience. That's a born-again experience. And I want to give you that opportunity tonight. And that's the beginning. That's the first prayer you pray to begin to live a prayerful life, a follower, as a follower of Jesus. So if you've never done that, I want to give you that opportunity tonight. And I also want to give the opportunity to the person, maybe you prayed that prayer at one point, but you know you fell away. You kind of just put God on the back shelf. You put that kind of lifestyle on the back shelf. And you, after tonight, you're like, man, I need to get with the program. I need to come back to God. I need to rededicate my life, if you may. And man, I'm going to keep following Jesus. If you're in here tonight and that's you, maybe your heart's pounding right now. You're like, yeah, I think that's me. That's you. I'm talking to you. I want to give you a moment right now to think about that decision. Don't fake God. You're not deceiving him. He literally sees your everything. He knows exactly where your heart's at. You can shine everybody else on in the building, but you cannot shine him on. Where you at? Have you called on the name of Jesus? Is he your Lord? Is he your Savior? Is he your everything? Is he your point? If you're in here tonight and you say, yes, I need to turn to Jesus, or I need to turn back to Jesus, I need to call on the name of Jesus. I need him. I'm a sinner. But man, thanks be to him. With him, I can be a saint. On the count of three, one. Come on, young person. Call on the name of Jesus. The Bible says today's the day of salvation. Two. On the count of three, raise your hand. Three, raise your hand in this place if you need to get born again or you want to rededicate your life. Three. Come on, all right, see those hands. Amen. I want to rededicate my life. I want to make it right. I want to make sure that I'm following Jesus with everything I got. I want everybody to stand up with me. We're all going to say this prayer together. Say, Father God. Come on, not like a second grade girl. Everybody stand up with me. Sorry, I should have, like, second grade-er. Girls are cooler than boys most of the time. Anyways, okay, say, Father God, I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord. He's the reason I'm alive. He's the point. I don't care about anything else. I want him. Father, direct my steps. Have my life. From here, this day forward, I'm going to be a follower of Jesus. I want to like what you like. I want to hate what you hate. And I want to serve you all the days of my life. Amen. You believe that? Come on, if you said that prayer for the first time, I want you to talk to Ben. He is the bald man in the back. He's got something against hair. We don't know why. And if you rededicated your life, I want you also to talk to Ben. And he's going to come up and just chat with you, talk with you, encourage you. Now, listen to me. One of the things a lot of times that we need to know as Christians is that God always forgives you. And truth be told, the Bible talks about it, that he's forgiven sin, period, past, present, future. He's forgiving you for the sin that you're going to commit tomorrow. But just like a working relationship, you got to go talk to him about it. If I went up to my wife and be like, you know what, we're married, you love me always, whack! And I smacked her in the side of the face and be like, peace out, love you. It'd be awkward. It would be a weird relationship that we had at the moment. There would have to be a moment of like, hey, baby, I know you love me. I know I love you. I slapped you. That was stupid. I'm going to call that for what it is. That was sin. That was wrong. And that was really stupid. I'm sorry, baby. And it's just this, it's not a matter of whether God's going to forgive you. He always forgives you. But it's a matter of clearing the air. And some of you guys need to learn how to do that. That's 1 John 1:9. Getting to the point where you're like, Father, that was sin. What I just did there, that was stupid. I'm sorry. I know you forgive me. I know that you love me. Wash me and cleanse me. That was dumb. And then the Bible says he forgives you. He's faithful and just. That's the beauty of our God. And so you need to remember that. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to sing one song. And we're just going to open up the altar for prayer.